When this government was elected to power, it was under the clear mandate of removing the inefficiencies and internal conflicts that had besieged the state for too long. We are duty-bound to restore our rightful place as a global leader in innovation and finance. If proof are needed of our commitment to reform, you need look no further than our revolutionary work in healthcare, where we have transformed what was a failing and overburdened national health service into the modern and competitive national insurance service. For the first time, we have a small government that uses big data to make wise and informed decisions on everything from government policy to personal tax, making sure we are not just competing in the global economic race, but succeeding in it. This is Arnold Mann. Arnold was what you might call a model citizen. That is to say, unremarkable. He paid taxes and premiums. He tried to keep ahead of his peers by upskilling when he could find the time and maintain comfortable metrics. That is not to say that Arnold was ignorant of the world he had inherited and the sickly seams of fear and darkness within it, but he did his best to protect his equally unremarkable family from it. He waited and he hoped. Then the new government entered on the office on a wave of popular support. They promised an end to insecurity, to vanquish the fears that Arnold had harbored for all those years. Not long after the celebrations ended, the package arrived, a letter, a leaflet, and a spit kit from the DNA mapping department of the newly formed National Health Insurance Service, the NHI. Mann was one of a privileged few to be selected for the first round of genetic testing and sampling for the new government database. With quiet excitement, Mann followed the kit's instructions and sent off his sample, awaited the results, results which might finally give him a sense of place in this world. Almost 6 months passed without a reply, and then finally, results arrived. Relief swept over him. The algorithm had classified him as healthy and comfortably average. But further down came a short caveat. There were some elevated risk indicators, but nothing he needed to worry about. More time passed, and he had all but forgotten about the test and the results when his NHI contributions bill arrived. His heart raced. The premiums were unaffordable, but he had no choice. This was, after all, the legislation the people wanted. It was better for society. The alternative was a corrective procedure, a genetic alteration at one of the government's licensed research clinics, but it came at a staggering cost. He pored over the NHI's policy guidelines. The algorithm made the core logic all too clear. Every individual's insurance contributions were calculated to reflect the potential healthcare costs associated with their genome. The system was fair, but how could he afford it? Lines of anxiety crossed his face as Mann tried to bury the cost of balancing the risk in his DNA, the risk the state had decided was an unpayable debt. In months, his family would begin to suffer. In years, he would lose everything. Fear and despair crept over Mann as he contemplates his options. Dynamic Genetics versus Mann is a design fiction by our studio Superflux. It centers around a near-future court case between the defendant, Arnold Mann, and Dynamic Genetics, a multinational genetics corporation who accuses Mann of obtaining unlicensed copies of its patented gene therapies. The project explores themes such as risk and control through a detailed and carefully crafted body of evidence, including the spit kit, the letters, and the images I showed earlier, as well as a range of other objects and artifacts, including this covert surveillance photograph from inside a black market clinic that appears to show Mann receiving counterfeit gene therapy. A forensic photograph documenting the layout of the crime scene. In the foreground, you see an improvised CO2 incubator used in the manufacture of illegal genetic therapies. A detail of the genetic therapy. Stolen Dynamic Genetics vials used as source materials in counterfeiting process. And these are a batch of counterfeit therapies found in the clinic. Boxes containing mice, which appear to have been used as test subjects. Sections of the defendant's machine-readable DNA with matches to Dynamic Genetics copyright material highlighted in yellow. And finally, a film showing the defendant being questioned. The lens of a court case as a superfiction mirroring current world organization proved to be a powerful way of constructing a narrative about a very human story about a vulnerable citizen who goes to extreme measures to avoid paying healthcare premiums. Technologies don't exist in isolation, and they interact with a rich and complex world that is often beyond their maker's control. As designers, we believe that it is important to think about the wider complexities within which these technologies will interact and play out, and in order to challenge the deeper assumptions about technological power and control. Aspects of this project might seem unsettling or even strange, but there are some real, very real trends and stories that back this project. In April 2013, the Coldiget Committee proposed new rules for data sharing, which would allow the government to build a DNA database of the whole population of England in the NHS by stealth. Whilst there's a remarkable research potential for this kind of a database, many people think it's invasive and liken it to the idea of a genetic panopticon. Zooming out, here is a current world map of the countries that are actively building nationwide DNA databases around the world. And UAE is leading the way in this by putting its entire population on a DNA database. For those with a leaning towards dystopia, it's fairly easy to extrapolate these trends into an NSA-like scenario, where you imagine a future where big data and genetics collide and government agencies have the potential to access our genetic information. And a justification that would no doubt sound very much like this.
The net effect is if you are a law-abiding citizen of this country, going about your business and your personal life, you have nothing to fear. Nothing to fear about the British state or intelligence agencies listening to the contents of your phone calls or anything like that.
Another real-world example of the themes we are exploring is the extreme measures people already undergo to afford even basic health care. Christina Agapakis from Daisy's talk told me about a 59-year-old man who had been jailed in the US on charges of larceny after allegedly robbing an RBC bank for $1 so that he could get health care in prison. With a growth in his chest, two ruptured discs, and no job, he felt that a 3-year stint in the prison would afford him the basic health care he needed. At the other end of this theme is biotech tourism, or what Priscilla Song calls biotech pilgrimage. Priscilla followed several people from around the world who went to Beijing Zhongmai Hospital to receive experimental stem cell treatments for extreme motor neuron diseases. It is a specialized treatment invented by Dr. Huang, who cultivates the cells of aborted fetuses and injects them into the brains and spines of his patients. Which goes to illustrate that how one nation's deviant entrepreneur is another nation's startup success story. Internally, China's biotech and genomics industry is booming. The country claims to be the first to use DNA testing, not just for inheritance and disease susceptibility, but also to determine genetic gifts. And this is anxiously lapped up by parents who have very high expectations from their only child, as illustrated in this video.
It's the stuff of childhood memories. Mom saying goodbye, kids heading off to summer camp. But here in Chongqing, China, this isn't any average camp. All of these kids, age 3 to 12, have already taken a DNA test that scientists say will help identify their genetic gifts. Over the next week, they will be scrutinized in environments from sports to art. And along with scientific results, observers will tell parents what talents they should nurture. This way, we can really understand our kids and help them develop, says one father. It's better to develop her talents earlier rather than later, says another mother. Before this test existed, it would take so long. Now we can find out more quickly and raise her based on what her natural talents are. Scientists claim this simple saliva swab collects a sample of more than 10,000 cells, enabling them to isolate 11 different genes that reveal critical information about the child's IQ, emotional control, focus, memory, athletic ability, and more.
Yeah, And the ambitions don't stop here. This could be soon the world's 2,000 smartest babies. China's largest genomics company, BGI, have collected DNA samples from 2,000 of the world's smartest people, sequencing their entire genomes in an attempt to identify the alleles which will determine human intelligence. Apparently, they're not far from finding them, and when they do, embryo screening will allow parents to pick their brightest zygote and potentially bump up every generation's IQ by 5 to 15 points. And closer to home, you have the company 23andMe. Over the last 6 years, 180,000 people have given saliva samples using their cute spit kit in exchange for valuable health and ancestry information. But the interesting thing is that recently the founder Anne Wojcicki, who happens to be the wife of Google's Sergey Brin, decided to monetize the genetic database by opening the information up for third-party developers. So you could start building new web-based interactive tools. Although current laws prohibit employers and insurance companies from getting access to your genetic information, schools, athletic organizations, and life insurance providers could potentially get their hands on your genetic data. The technology that is set to revolutionize medicine and genomics is also developing rapidly. The Dutch company Unicore will soon start selling the West's first approved gene therapy for a very rare disease called LLPD, which is lipoprotein lipase deficiency, and it will be sold for $1 million per patient. Currently, there are 80 such gene therapies in clinical trial. George Church, a pioneer of genomics and synthetic biology, in his new book, How Synthetic Biology Will Reinvent Nature and Ourselves, talks about how we are entering an age of limitless capacities to remake us and the world around us, and we will only be stopped by our good judgment. He talks about a new wave of revolutionary gene therapy using synthetic biology, which will allow us to edit precisely human genes to not only cure rare diseases like cystic fibrosis, but also to make us sensitive and to make us sort of resistant to things like AIDS, so that we all take on a new kind of superpower. But Church is more than aware of the reasons for making this extremely safe and for spreading the knowledge and understanding about these technologies, and so many years ago he founded this thing, personalgenomes.org, which is a large cohort study where 100,000 volunteers will be giving their genetic information so that they can sequence and publish entire genomes for personalized medicine and research. He also plays a very active role in this, the iGEM competition, also known as the Olympics of Synthetic Biology. 3,000 students forming 191 teams from 34 countries participated in last year, and so many more are editing and building living organisms this very minute. Some of the projects are pretty outstanding. For instance, a couple of years ago, the students at the University of Edinburgh engineered a strain of bacteria that glows green in the presence of explosives, so that when you drop them over landmine fields, then they will sort of react with the chemicals and start glowing fluorescent green wherever explosives were found. Alongside such open initiatives is the popular DIY movement called the DIY Bio, where groups of biohackers and interested citizens have cheap and easy access to knowledge and tools that were so far the remit of labs and scientists. So this is a DNA printer hacked from a very cheap inkjet printer by the folks at BioCurious Lab. And for those who are interested, the instructions can be found on instructables.com. So we are seeing how it's not just about governmental control and corporate profit, but also about technological empowerment. These are images from the same lab where six-year-old students kids are learning the hello world of biotech by programming lab bacteria with a DNA from a jellyfish so that they can make glowing green fluorescent protein. And the list of such projects goes on and on. What these trends show is how technology starts manifesting itself in complex relationships as it starts interacting with politics, economics, cultures, as well as our wants, needs, and desires. This sort of complexity is true not just for genomics and synthetic biology, but most, if not all, technologies. We recognize that the technology can at once be a weapon, a toy, a business, a fetishized object, and a source of empowerment. And whilst it may seem entrenched in known law and culture, that law and culture is also shifting rapidly. What might be abhorrent today may be tomorrow's new horizon. Under these circumstances, the notion of a normal world should be continually questioned and assumptions challenged. Culture is not always your friend, governments don't always have your best interests at heart, and criminals are not always your enemies. So how do we think outside of what Venkatesh Rao calls the normality field and break the hypnosis derived from the numbing effect of technologies, marketing, and the sensationalist sort of headlines that are pervasive in our media landscape? At Superflux, our position on this is to interrupt the status quo by something we call design for the new normal. Projects like the one I showed at the start of the talk aim to cut through established narratives and about the present and the future by using stories, cautionary tales, artifacts, scenarios, and superfictions to present the sheer breadth of often unsettling possibilities that lie ahead of us. Such evocative approaches help us to see the world from a new perspective, allowing for an emotional connection with the raw weirdness of our times. Thank you.